Okay. Now, I know that you have partnerships with, for example, the Banco Central ng Pilipinas, the Department of Budget and Management, different government agencies, and the DTI, the Trade Investment Department, has already said that the AI solutions and cloud platform of Microsoft can play a pivotal role in helping enhance skills development in the Philippines. Just describe what can change in terms of business with Microsoft's AI solutions.
Again, Microsoft Copilot will be woven into our products and including Microsoft Bing. So when I think about the ways in which this could help, there are a number of different things. The first is sort of automating business solutions and optimizing supply chain. So using artificial intelligence to do a better job of getting goods and services where they need to be on time in a way that they are very marketable and available. Another area is government services, and that might be a government service for social services. It could be banking. It could be housing, those kinds of things, using essentially a chatbot so that the customer or the citizen or the consumer can interface with government services to more quickly find what they need and get information about that. In terms of business, we all have things that we would love to do more efficiently, me included. I have become a particular fan of Microsoft Teams, where in a meeting with five or six different people, I can ask Teams to give me a summary of the meeting afterwards and the action items, which I always check. You have to check because you're never, nothing is better than the human. But it just saves so much time to do things like that. So those are ways in which you can think about that. I think there are just tremendous opportunities in the areas of healthcare and education as well. I recently read an article in Seattle, where I am. There is a cancer institute that has been using artificial intelligence to identify early markers of cancer in women. And this is something that has never been done before, and able to really arrest cancer early on to ensure that more women stay alive. There are many, many opportunities like that in the field of health and the field of research. Another thing that I think is just really interesting, I was reading recently that about 96% of research papers that academics share with each other are written in English. Obviously, most of the world does not speak English. So being able to use AI tools for translation really enables people around the globe to have first-quality research partnerships with academic institutions. So everything from these kinds of high-level things to everyday use on your mobile phone to get a government service that you otherwise might have to show up at an office for are all different ways in which we can use artificial intelligence.
All right. Now, how is Microsoft battling the concerns with AI?
Well, I could take that a number of different ways, but let me just sort of start by saying we, about 6 or 7 years ago, started to think about what responsible AI means. And that means different things to different people. For us, we actually created an office under our president, Brad Smith, staffed with lawyers, technologists, anthropologists. And what we did with that office is ensure that every deployment that we make of artificial intelligence runs through that office. And we've provided guidelines for our business. So we then have engineers who are within each of the product groups that are responsible for ensuring compliance with these guidelines for responsible AI. And when something appears to be a more sensitive use case, maybe it identifies personal identifiable information, for example, we bring that back to the office for a one-on-one iteration and testing. We've made this framework available to all of our customers. You can find it on our website. We work with our customers so that they can deploy the same things. We also are very engaged in international agencies around the world to try to ensure that we have standards that we can adopt as a corporation and as corporations around the globe. But frankly, we know that that there needs to be some governance and regulation. And we are open to that and are working quite closely with governments around the world to think about what are the next steps. As we think about it, it's really important, I think, from a government regulatory standpoint, to address the highest risk cases, the things that we know are very important. Those are the sensitive use cases around privacy, security, managing information, and making decisions about what artificial intelligence should do and what it should not do, what we should not have artificial intelligence do. And we really want to work with government agencies to focus on what are the outcomes, what are the principles that we want to have engaged, because we also want to be able to innovate. We want to be competitive. And so we really want to try to, you know, do things better and do things in a way that is helpful to consumers. So thinking about regulation in that high use case and then thinking about it in outcomes, but also knowing that we need to collaborate with government. This is not an area where we should forge ahead by ourselves. We really need that strong collaboration, and we welcome it and we actually initiate it.
All right. Now, before we go, I know you have a history. You have your own personal history with the Philippines. I think that would be interesting to share, considering it's your first time here. And yet, if you go back to your family tree, you've had, there's been a very deep connection somehow.
And I'm so glad you mentioned that. It was one of the reasons that I was so excited to come here, because in my family history, my great aunt Vera Snap, was a school teacher in a little farm town in Kansas, a town of about 3,000, 4,000 people. Somehow, I don't quite know how, Vera, as a school teacher, came across the ocean on the USS Thomas to teach English to the Filipinos in 1941 or so. She loved it. She thought it was a beautiful spot. And frankly, since I've been here, I can hardly understand why. It looks very little like, you know, the flat wheat fields of Kansas, I have to say. It is gorgeous. The weather is gorgeous. The architecture is beautiful. She came back, and her family really encouraged her not to return to the Philippines. She did. And so she came back, and the difficult part of the story was that she was among the 5,000 civilians, teachers and nurses who were interned at the University of Santo Tomas. So wow. She survived, and she came back to the United States, but that story lives on. So I made it a point. I asked the tour guide to take me there. He said, nobody wants to go to the University of Santo Tomas. It's not on our tour list, you know. I said, well, it's really important to me. And so I was able to look in and get a real sense of her. And it was just so gratifying. Thank you for asking that.
All right. Well, that's beautiful. And thank you for being in the Philippines. Thank you, Mary.
It is my pleasure. I hope to come back. I'll ask you for tips next time.
Yes, definitely, please. So that's Microsoft Vice President for Strategic Initiatives, Mary Snap.